Assalamu alaikum everyone, welcome to another lesson. In today's class, we would be covering from question 10 to question 20 of May June 2020, paper 1-2. If you haven't seen the part 1 yet, I would leave the link down in the description box. Secondly, I do assure you guys one video per week, but I cannot promise more than that. Although, I will try my best to cover as much content and as many past papers as I can before the May-June 2021 series. Now, more than that, in the description box, I would leave down a link to our Instagram page, which has more information on the ongoing O-level and A-level sessions. Without further ado, let's begin. So question number 11. PCl5 decomposes as shown. So you have been given an equation and they have given you some information, all right? And it's a typical question on CAIE if you observe. And generally what CAIE is that it is the concentration of products divided by concentration of reactants. And if I were to be even more specific, looking at this equation, our products are PCl3, so it's the concentration of PCl3. Now, in the power, we get the coefficients in this stoichiometric equation. In this case, all of them are 1, so the power is 1. I don't really need to write that. Multiplied by the concentration of the other products, in this case Cl2, divided by the concentration of the reactants, which in this case is PCl5. Okay, so this is our CAIE expression, so do keep that in mind. Now, here's my number one tip for doing all questions that involve CAIE. That is, write down all of the molecules and substances that are involved in the reaction, and then write down I, R, E. This is extremely important. I starts for initial, R stands for reacted, and E stands for equilibrium. So this is talking about concentrations at three different points. Remember that I kind of like to have a line between the products and the reactants to differentiate them. Remember that for the products, the reacted is going to be nothing, all right? There would be a formed, but reacted is nothing. Now, let's begin. So they have given us that initially, all right, initially our concentration, our moles for PCl5 are 1 mole, 1 mole, 1 mole each, all right? And because they've given us the volume as 1 dm cube, the concentration for each of them will turn out to be 1 mole per dm cube. So initially I have 1 mole per dm cube of PCl5, 1 mole of PCl3, and 1 mole of Cl2. And then they say at equilibrium, we have 1.8 moles of PCl3. So what I have is that for PCl3 at equilibrium, I have 1.8 moles. So tell me this, how many moles of PCl3 have been formed? If you calculate that, I will add formed here, F stands for formed. 0.8 moles of PCl3 have been formed in this reaction. Now, using simple ratios, all right, just use simple ratios, which you will get from this molecular equation, write down the ratios. So this is 1:1:1, all right? Now, tell me this, if 0.8 moles of PCl3 have been formed in your, you know, from your logic, what do you think? How many moles of PCl or Cl2 would be formed? If 0.2 moles of PCl3 is being formed, then using this 1:1, we should also get 0.8 moles of chlorine. So you get formed 0.8 moles for chlorine, and that totals it up to as what? 1.8 as well. And looking at PCl5, because these are the products, they will always be formed. The reactant is always reacted and not formed. So looking at the reacted, what do you think? If 0.8 moles of PCl3 have been formed, and as they are in 1:1, how many moles of PCl5 would or should possibly decompose? Use this ratio method, cross multiply, and X will again turn out to be 0.8. That means 0.8 moles of PCl5 should decompose. So reacted are 0.8 moles, and that totals up to 1. We have to do subtraction here. Why? Because remember, for the reactant, we always subtract. For the product, we always add. So for a product, you add. For reactant, you subtract. Because the reactant reacts while the product is formed. So formed is addition and reaction is subtraction. So you get 0.2 here. And now let's plug in the values. I get 1.8 into 1.8 divided by 0.2. And solving that gives, solving that gives 16.2. So your answer is D. I hope that makes sense. Okay, let's move on. Question number 12. The fifth, now very important, the fifth to the eighth ionization energies of four elements in period 3 of the periodic table are shown. They're saying which refers to chlorine. Now, chlorine is in group 7, which means that it has 7 valence electrons, which means that, remember that the big jump between ionization energies occur when you move from one shell to another. So let's say this is N is equal to 1 and this is N is equal to 2. It is between these two that you will get to see a big jump in IE. So big IE jump. So remember, when shell number changes, you get a big jump in ionization energy. So for chlorine, the valence electrons are 7. So I would see a big jump from the 7th to the 8th ionization energy, because 7th refers to the ejection of the 7th electron and 8th refers to the ejection of the 8th electron. And because chlorine has 7 valence electrons, the 8th ionization energy refers to an electron which is being removed from an inner shell. So we would see a big jump between the ionization energy. So let's see. So 7 to 8, well, not a huge jump. You like approximately see about a 5,000 jump between the 6th, 7th and 8th. So it's not A. Let's look at B. So a huge jump between 6th and 7th, not really between 7th and 8th, so not B. Looking at C, you see a huge jump between 7th and 8th, so the answer would be C. Looking at D, there's a small jump, and a small jump, so it's definitely not D. And if I were to tell you from which groups they belong to, this right here, because there was no huge jump, there was a steady trend or a steady increase, this right here would be argon. And this right here, because we see a steady increase of, up till the 6th point, this one would be in group 6, which would be sulfur. And this right here, because there was a huge jump from the 5th to 6th, this would be in the 5th group. And this right here would be phosphorus. Okay, let's move on. And the answer, however, is C. Okay, question number 13. So we have a magnesium nitrate which decomposes when heated to give a white solid and a mixture of gases. And one of the gases released is an oxide of nitrogen. Now, this is part of the course. You must know the decomposition of the carbonates and the nitrates for group 2 elements. And generally, this is what you would get to see. So you would have a group 2 nitrate, okay, which would decompose to give you an MO plus NO2 plus O2, and the ratios would be 2, 4, and 1. So these would be the ratios, and this would be a solid, a gas, and a gas. And this is the mixture of gases which the examiner is talking about. Now, simply, I'll replace the M with Mg. Well, that's a horrible color. Let me change that. So we will replace that with MgO. Okay. So here's the thing. I have 7.4 grams, okay, of magnesium nitrate, okay. So we want to find the mass of X, and X we are referring to, X is the name, another name for NO2 here. So first of all, let's find the number of moles of MgNO32, that should be the first thing. It would be 7.4 divided by the MR of magnesium nitrate, which in this case is 148.3, and therefore the moles will turn out to be 0.04989. Okay. Now I have the moles of magnesium. Let's compare the coefficients. So I have 2 moles here and I have 4 moles here. So the ratio simplified between them is 1:2. So let's use that 1:2. So if moles of magnesium nitrate are 0.04989, right? So what would be X cross multiply? And in other words, you're just multiplying the moles of magnesium nitrate with 2. And that would give you 0.099797. Now that you have moles of nitrogen dioxide, you should know that moles is equal to mass over MR. So as the moles are 0.099797, we need to find the mass. The MR is 46 and the mass turns out to be 4.59, which is approximately 4.6. So the answer is D. This is simple moles. Okay, question number 14. Which statement explains why iodine is less volatile than chlorine? One thing I want to clarify here, whether it's volatility, boiling point, melting point, density, any physical property, they are linked with the intermolecular forces of attraction. Extremely important to remember. Whatever physical property we are discussing, it is linked with the intermolecular forces of attraction. And remember one thing, the bonding, right, or maybe not even the bond, I would say the intramolecular forces, IMF, okay, they are inversely proportional to volatility. What I mean by that is, or in other words, the stronger the bonding is, the less volatile something would be. So stronger the intermolecular forces of attraction are in a covalent molecule, the weaker or the lesser the volatility of that molecule would be. Now, if iodine is less volatile than chlorine, that means iodine has a stronger intermolecular forces of attraction than chlorine. And now identify those intermolecular forces of attraction. Iodine and chlorine are nonpolar covalent molecules. And therefore, what do they have? They have van der Waal forces, which we also term as temporary dipole-induced dipole forces. And what do you think these depend on? These depend on the number of electrons, firstly, and they also depend on the branching. Now, in this case, the question is not about branching. That's something we consider when we move to organic chemistry. The question over here, because iodine and chlorine are simple straights, you know, they look something like this. So there's no branching involved here. So we can ignore this. The number of electrons. And it's kind of obvious, you know, iodine comes below chlorine in halogens and it has more electrons. And I2 would have more electrons than chlorine. And because it has more electrons, it would have a stronger van der Waal forces. And because it has a stronger van der Waal forces, it would be less volatile. So let's see which is coherent with this reasoning. Chlorine is more electronegative. That has nothing to do with physical properties. The greater number of electrons in iodine leads to larger temporary dipole-induced dipole forces. Absolutely correct. The II bond energy is smaller than CCl bond energy. That's wrong because these are referring to covalent bonds, remember. And covalent bonding is your intramolecular bonding. And that does not determine your physical properties. Remember, physical properties are determined by intermolecular forces. Okay, D. The iodine molecule have a stronger permanent dipole. Well, they don't have permanent dipole. They are non-polar molecules. Only polar covalent molecules have permanent dipole forces. So let's move on. Question number 15. Now, in my opinion, this question is kind of weird, but let's do it. I personally found it a bit weird, to be honest. Okay, so we have ammonium carbonate, which is decomposing into ammonia, right? And this is basically the equation for the decomposition of ammonium carbonate. One of the products is ammonia carbon. The carbonate ions always give off carbon dioxide when heated. and the remaining will result in the formation of water. Now, the way that I tackle this question, looking at the options A and B, I see that they have involved the Bronsted-Lowry theory. And talking about the Bronsted-Lowry theory, if something accepts hydrogen atoms, if something accepts a proton, which is H positive ion, it's a base, and if something donates that H positive ion, it's an acid. And in this case, well, you can clearly see ammonium ion perhaps is losing an H positive ion, so it is technically behaving as a Bronsted-Lowry acid. And well, in the case of carbonate, it's not exactly gaining a H positive ion, so I'm not sure if I would call that as a Bronsted-Lowry base. So here's another way that I would look at this question. Here's the other thing. Well, you have water here. When carbon dioxide goes into water, it gives you carbonic acid. So carbon dioxide is basically an acid, and ammonia in water is basically a base. Now, if you have an acid base on this side, the ones that they are coming from or the ones that they are forming from become the opposite. You know, the acid 1 base 1 theory and the acid 2 and the base 2 theory. So the carbon dioxide comes from the carbonate ion, and if carbon dioxide is the acid, the carbonate ion has to be a base. More precisely, it would be a conjugate base. And ammonia arises from this ammonium ion, and if ammonia is a base, this would be an acid, right? I'm using this logic from the acid 1 base 1 and the acid 2 base 2 theory, which might have other names, but this is how you say it. And looking at this, we can clearly see that the carbonate ions are acting as a Bronsted-Lowry base. So the answer would be A. The answer would be B. It can't be A, whether you use this logic or whether you talk in terms of the fact that ammonium ions are losing their H ions, or they're losing their H positive ions. So they can't, if this is the acid, this can't be the acid as well. It has to be the base. So that's the case, okay? And as far as oxidizing agents and reducing agents are concerned, well, technically, CO3 is losing an oxygen molecule. It's definitely not a reducing agent, right? It's definitely losing an oxygen molecule, but at the same time, it's not oxidizing anything. It's just forming an H2O molecule. It's, you know, if in case it was oxidizing and if oxygen was being gained by the ammonium or ammonia, in that case it would have made sense, but it's not technically oxidizing energy. It's just oxidizing agent. And one way to confirm that is you can even write down the oxidation state. So on carbon, it's +4 over here, and carbon is +4 over here, so there's no change in oxidation number, and that clearly states that it's not changing its oxidation state. So it's not neither a reducing or an oxidizing agent. Okay, moving on. I hope that made sense. I personally found that question weird, but I tried to communicate my logic to you guys. I hope it made sense though. Okay, so one molecule of an oxide of element Z reacts with 6 molecules, that's the hint, and produces an acidic compound. Okay, what is element Z? Now, for these questions, your memorization about the reaction equations for your your physical chemistry should be very strong. You know, you should actually, you know, the inorganic chemistry bit of A levels, it is full of equations. And personally, if you want to score really well in the exam, do memorize them. That's my personal advice. That's what I did, and that's what I would suggest as well. So even though I don't remember the exact equations, you should know that the oxide, because we're talking about oxides, aluminum oxide does not dissolve in water, and it does not react with water. There's too strong of a bonding for it to even react with water. That is something that you should absolutely know. If you don't, you need to go back and revise your inorganic chemistry. Then coming to silicon oxide also SiO2 also does not react with water, so that cancels out A and B. Now coming to phosphorus and sulfur, both of them will go in water and produce acidic solutions. Now the question is, which one of them would use up 6 molecules of water? So in the case of sulfur, can actually there are two possible oxides of sulfur, sulfur dioxide and sulfur trioxide. And if sulfur dioxide goes in water, it gives you H2SO3, that is phosphorus acid. And you can clearly see it is balanced H2SO3, right? And your sulfur trioxide, when that goes in water, it gives you sulfuric acid. Now, what do you see here? One molecule of water reacting with one molecule of SO2 and one molecule of SO3. What does the question state? One molecule reacts with 6 molecules. So that cancels out D, and the answer is B, but this is through elimination. If I were to give you the actual equation, well, if you memorize the actual equation, P5O10 does react with 6 molecules of water, and this gives us H3PO4. And to balance it off, there are 6 here. I would actually write 5 here, okay? And that will solve the question. And so you can clearly see that your phosphorus is reacting with, the phosphorus pentoxide is reacting with your 6 molecules of water, right? Actually, I think there's a bit issue in my balancing. This is supposed to be 4. This is supposed to be 4. My bad, guys. This can be simplified to P2O5 if you like, but in that case, you would only get 3 molecules of water which are reacting with H3PO4, okay? In this case, you would get a 2 here. So my bad on this bit, but there you go. Remember, phosphorus has it has multiple oxides, but if you use the pentoxide one, you will end up with 6 molecules of water reacting to give this. Now, one thing that I would like to state, this question for me worked more, if I were a student attempting this MCQ, for me personally, the elimination method is always a good choice. But if you have memorized these equations, then deciding that the answer is phosphorus won't take you long. But if you haven't memorized them, no issue. Go by the elimination method to be confirmed that yes, exactly, answer is B and nothing else. Okay, moving on. Which property shows an increase from magnesium to barium? So you have magnesium at the top of group 2 right here, and then you move all the way down and you have barium somewhere here at the bottom. Now, what they're actually saying is, what property increases as you move down the group in period in group 2? So first they say the ionization energy. Well, you should know that down the group, the ionization energy decreases, so it can't be A. The oxidizing power of the metals. Now, what does oxidizing power means? It means the ease with which they can cause something else to oxidize. And causing something else to oxidize means being reduced themselves. And being reduced themselves means to gain electrons. So in other words, how easily do these metals gain electrons? Now, here's the thing. As you move down the group, the atom becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. And as it becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, the ability to gain an electron, for example, this is magnesium, all right? And here's the nucleus. Let me make the nucleus with another color. Here's the nucleus. And then this is barium, this much. And let's say I have an electron here and an electron here. Now, the ease with which this nucleus can exert a force of attraction on this electron will be much more than the ease with which this nucleus can, exert a force of attraction on this electron. The reason being definitely the distance and also the shielding effect. So therefore, definitely as you move down the group, the ease with which the atom can gain electrons decreases. So the oxidizing power decreases. It does not increase down the group. Instead, the reducing power increases. Now, the solubility of the hydroxides, well, yes, the answer is C. This is a trend that you should memorize. Again, inorganic chemistry is mainly memorization. The solubility of the hydroxides does increase down the group. The solubility of the sulfates, well, that decreases down the group. Question number 18. So we have a test tube which has HBr and HI, and we are heating it to some temperature, but for both of them it's the same temperature. It says which combination of observations is possible. So, you know, if you see this, there's no option where this is also showing something and this is also showing something. Well, by the way, if I have a sample, let's say I have a sample, actually it's a test tube, I made a box, but if I have a sample and I'm heating it, right, or I'm raising it to some temperature, what do you think the reaction should be? Shouldn't it be decomposition? Well, it is. I hope you know that. It is decomposition. We know that HBr will decompose, give us a hydrogen gas and bromine gas, and bromine gas is brown. It has brown vapors. And similarly, if it was hydrogen iodide, that would decompose and give us hydrogen ions and iodine. And iodine gas, I hope you know, is purple. It has purple vapors, right? These things you should remember. Okay. So you can clearly see that in neither options, we can see both of them producing something. So that clearly means that there's no such scenario and we are at some low temperature where you can't basically decompose the other one. Now, my question to you is the bonding stronger in HI or HBr? And I'm hoping, truly hoping, that you would say that the bonding in HI is weaker. And why do I say that? That is because if you look at bromine, now bromine is, it is smaller in size, so the overlap of the orbitals would be more effective, they would be much more closer, so the covalent bond would be strong. But for HI, iodine is such a huge, it's a very big atom, so when that overlaps with hydrogen, there's not a lot of overlap, and it's more like the force of attraction. Because what is a covalent bond? It's the force of attraction between the nuclei of the atoms and the shared pair of electrons. So the bigger the atom would be, the lesser its force of attraction is towards the shared pair of electrons. So HI is definitely has a bond which is weaker. So this is more likely to decompose as compared to HBr. And therefore, A and B I can cancel out, because this can't happen that HI is not changing and HBr is. Because even if the temperature is low, we would expect HI to decompose first. And then we come to C and D. And as I said, iodine has purple vapors, so the answer is D. Moving on, question number 19. Most modern cars are filled with catalytic converters in the exhaust system, and which of the three gases are removed? Well, this question seems very tricky to some people, but you know, it's simple knowledge. And I think the problem here is that most of the time the students are not told about this. So they don't know, they're just guessing their way through this MCQ. And this has repeated many times in the past as well. So I'll try to clear that confusion for once and for all. So first things first, remember that in a catalytic converter, you have two types of reactions going on. You have oxidation reactions going on and you have reduction reactions going on. Now, which reactions are these? Well, for reduction, you have two reactions. If NO, nitrogen monoxide, goes into the catalytic converter, it will reduce it to nitrogen and oxygen. That's the first reaction. And the second reaction is that you have two NO2, which is nitrogen dioxide. And when that goes in, okay, that gives you nitrogen and oxygen again, okay? And if I were to balance that, well, the above is balanced and the bottom will be balanced if I add a 2 here, okay? So these are the two reactions. These are the only two reactions that happen in the reduction side of the catalytic converter. As far as oxidation is concerned, there are again two reactions. You have carbon monoxide that goes in and you get carbon dioxide. Okay, and you can add 1/2 or maybe 2 here. Okay, that would make sense. And the second one is hydrocarbons. You have any hydrocarbon and that is also oxidized and that also gives you carbon dioxide but also water. So just remember these, okay? So all I want you to do is memorize this oxidation in the catalytic converter. There are two reactions, just memorize these and memorize these. These are the reduction reactions that happen in the catalytic converter. Let me repeat myself. No other reaction occurs in the catalytic converter. What do you see here now? You see carbon monoxide, you see hydrocarbons, and you see the oxides of nitrogen. Do you see anything else? No, you don't. So let's look at the options. So which three gases are removed by the catalytic converter? Carbon monoxide, yes. Hydrocarbons, yes. Nitrogen oxides, yes. Answer is A. Let's move on. Carbon monoxide, yes. Carbon dioxide, well, no, that's the product. It doesn't remove it. It actually produces it. Nitrogen oxide, it's true, but then that makes it wrong because of carbon dioxide. Carbon monoxide, yes. Nitrogen oxides, yes. Sulfur dioxide, nope. Sulfur dioxide definitely is an impurity in the atmosphere. It does cause acid rain, but it is not removed by the catalytic converter, unfortunately. So let's move on to question the part D. Hydrocarbons, yes. Nitrogen oxides, yes. Sulfur dioxide, again, no. So the answer is A. And here's the thing. I'll make this simple model of the catalytic converter, and maybe you can just, you know, you can just memorize it, right? Just memorize this, and that will be more than enough for you. Make it down in your notes, and you will never get this question wrong. And remember, this question does repeat itself a lot in the past papers. So here I would set in the reactants, and from here we would get the products. The reactants, remember, will be the oxides of nitrogen. As I showed, it could be nitrogen monoxide or nitrogen dioxide. It could be carbon monoxide, okay, and it could be the hydrocarbons. That's it. And the products would be, well, there would be nitrogen, okay, there would be water, and there would be carbon dioxide. That's it. Just memorize these two and you will do yourself a huge favor. Okay, so that's all you need to know about the catalytic converter. I mean, there are a few details about the catalyst used and all of that, but maybe I'll make a separate video on that. But for now, for this MCQ, remember, these will always be the reactants and these will always be the products from the catalytic converter. Moving on. Last question. Now, this video has become very long, but it's okay. You know, at least we did a lot of learning today. So, question number 20. Compound X is shown, okay? And X is treated separately with NaOH and LiAlH4 to give Y and Z. What is Y and Z? Before I look at the options, a few things. What is this? It's a carboxylic acid group. It's a carboxylic acid group, right? What is this? Please don't tell me it's phenol. It's not phenol. This right here is a secondary alcohol. And this is exactly where many people would go wrong. They would expect this to be phenol. They would assume it's phenol. Why? Because there's a ring going on and you have OH attached. Well, no, that is not what phenol looks like. Phenol is an OH group attached to a benzene, a benzene structure. So you can either make this, all right? You can either make this and then say, oh, well, this is OH. Then maybe, yes, you could say it's phenol. Or a much better structure of that would be to make a circle in the middle, a ring, and then say this is phenol. Do you see, you know, the ring structure being any similar to this or any similar to this? No. So this is not phenol. Remember that. It's not phenol. It's a secondary alcohol. Okay. So when we look at LiAlH4, well, LiAlH4 is a reducing agent. Alcohols are not reduced. Remember that they are oxidized, but they're never reduced. Your aldehydes, your ketones, and your carboxylic acids are reduced. So this carboxylic acid group will be reduced. And here's the thing: just memorize this. For reduction, if you have COOH, it would be, and maybe a better way to write that would be, if you have RCOOH, when you reduce that, you would get RCH2. OH, which is a primary alcohol. If you get RCHO, which is an aldehyde, you would get R again CH2H, because both of them are formed from the oxidation of a primary alcohol. And if you have RC and then R and CO here, this is a ketone. Remember, this would be R CHOH and R. This right here is a ketone, and that arises from the oxidation of a secondary alcohol. So just remember these, okay, and you will be fine with the deduction questions. So I have LiLH4 and I have a COOH here. So COOH gets replaced by CH2OH. So CH2OH will be wrong, that this remains the same. And then this remains the same, so D is wrong. So we have A and C remaining. Now, let's look at NaOH aqueous. So NaOH aqueous, remember that when the examiner does not talk about the temperature, forget about hydrolysis. NaOH will solely act as a base and it will react with acids. So if you have carboxylic acid, it will react with that. And in the case of phenol, because phenol is also acidic, it would also react with phenol. So what many people would do here is they would choose option C, assuming that this OH group is basically making or is part of phenol. It's not phenol, as I explained earlier in the question. So don't make this mistake. Alcohols are not acidic enough to react with NaOH, so it can't be C. Alcohols only react with sodium metal, not NaOH aqueous. So the answer is A, because NaOH aqueous will react with this acid, carboxylic acid. It cannot react with alcohols. So the answer is going to be A. So there you go, guys. That's all for now. We covered from question number 10 to question number 20 of May-June 2020 paper 1-2. I hope you guys found this helpful. If you did, give it a thumbs up and maybe leave a comment down below if you want me to cover a specific topic or a video or generally any comments. And do not forget to subscribe to the channel. Till then, till the next video, khuda hafiz.